In a lot of ways, I kind of grew up with the festival a little bit because, you know, my thing is now like pretty much 50 years of being a band leader and, you know, taking people around and playing music. And, you know, I knew Claude really well. And, you know, it's a very special place, no question. And I mean, not to mention just the place is just unreal. It's like got to be one of the most beautiful places on the planet. You know, the issue that comes up all the time of classical music, jazz, rock, honestly, those are meaningless terms for me. I'm interested in music, and I've always been interested particularly in music that has a sort of creative identity. And I mean, however that manifests itself, I'm gonna like it. And in my case, I mean, yeah, I could very happily go play 2 hours of written music by a great composer, or play for 2 hours totally free with some really good improvisers. And I'm really happy to play incredibly loud. And I don't mind playing so soft you can't even hear it. And I like playing really inside the chords and, you know, understanding all of that kind of stuff. And I also like playing out of the chords. And I like playing really electric and then also just a nylon string guitar. I mean, these are all elements that are available to me, with the kind of prime directive being storytelling. And to me, that sort of communicative quality mixed with kind of high level creativity in whatever way it shows up in a musician, those are the musicians that I like to hang around with. Steve Reich is a fantastic example of that. He's not an improviser, nor was I asked to be an improviser. And on the other hand, nor should he be, because his language is kind of perfect for what it is he hopes to communicate. And to me, that's kind of the key, is people who are able to develop a vocabulary that's specific to who they are, so that they can then represent the stories that they hope to communicate to people effectively. And if there is one thing that is kind of notable or unique about my thing, it's probably that there is no boundary. You know, there's no reason for there to be a boundary to me. And I'm certainly not the only musician like that. There's a number of musicians. And to me, it's like the generation just above me really set a standard. And by that, I mean Keith Jarrett, Gary Burton, Chick Corea, Jack DeJohnette, that group of people. They're all like 10 to 12 years or so older than me. You know, that's what I'm talking about. There's no reason why any of them would have limited what they do to one aspect of music. They've all done lots of different things. And they've also, I think, met a standard that has been established by the greatest musicians. That's something that I worry about a little bit, is that I see a lot of super talented younger musicians that are kind of comparing themselves to each other. And I never did that. To me, it was always like compared to John Coltrane or compared to Bach or what. And I mean, compared to that, it's like I need to go home right now and practice, you know. There's never been a moment where there's been anything other than that in my mind. Sometimes I hear from younger guys like, oh, it must have been so great back in the... No, it was impossible then. And then, you know, I remember talking with Roy Haynes, like, man, it must have been so great playing on 52nd Street with Bird. He said, oh man, it sucked. We couldn't even hear ourselves, just a bunch of rich white people talking. Art Tatum was playing intermission piano, you couldn't even hear him. you know, I think each generation has this mythology that somehow, oh, it must have been so much easier. No, it's always been impossible. And then I also hear from people, it's like, wow, everything's been done. You know, what can I do after this? Man, I face exactly the same thing. I mean, you know, after West Montgomery, what can anybody do, you know? And I mean, for me, it's sort of like, yeah, I had to face that. And I know a few other people who did too. Gary Burton kind of invented a new way to play. You know, my best friend for a number of years was Jaco Pastorius, and we were both kind of just these two guys playing bad shows in Miami, but we were both on kind of like a mission from God to like change the shit up, you know? So it's impossible. It can't be done, but you know, if you understand that, that at least gives you a realistic picture of what it is you're trying to do. Like, regarding soundtracks in general, I probably did 15 or so, pretty much from the early 80s till the early 90s. And I kind of realized, well, first of all, I did them all and I never got fired. Everybody was pretty happy with it. So I kind of understood, okay, this is something I can do, but it takes a really long time. And if you do it really well, it's almost good if nobody notices it exactly. And I kind of got to that where I could write stuff and it would just be right. And then I sort of realized, because it takes months to do it, and also I don't interface with Hollywood at all well. I mean, it's a community and a world that I'm not that interested in. And usually when they hire the composer, it's at the very end. There's millions of dollars at stake. And you are kind of expected to save stuff, which music really can do. And I kind of could do that, but I just sort of realized if I've got 3 months of my life to give to something, I'd rather do a record or a tour or practice or something. So I sort of retired from doing film scores.
You know what Ennio Morricone used to say? There's no bad music that would kill a film, and there's no good music that would save a good film.
He may be an exception to that. Because he's definitely saved some movies, in my opinion. So.
Le tue cose non ci sono più. Bisogna andare via per molto tempo, per moltissimi anni, per ritrovare al ritorno la tua gente.